We're all living in America.
Hey people, here's your governor with a message for you, and you should listen to it because it happened to me.
But discrimination isn't always that obvious. Sometimes more subtle, but in many ways more insidious. And institutionalized discrimination that's hidden behind a smiling face.
Everybody, how you doing? Today is what, the 27th?
Oh, don't make a whole recording.
No, I gotta do it. This is the video, We the Undersigned. That's right here. No. We the Undersigned want, that's it, that's all we want. And, hi,
Okay, no problem. I'll get my laptop. I don't have my laptop with me. I go to McDonald's.
No check.
Yeah, that's what I was sitting here. See, that's my bag.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, see, that video, We the Undersigned, was a video that once Charmaine McPherson investigated and prosecuted for abusing veterans at the Cromwell House in the Bronx, New York. And that video, along with the mini video that you're about to see, is what got me locked up in the VA hospital. And now Dr. Julia's calling me. When they violated confidentiality. What's up? I don't have it with me. When they violated confidentiality and went to the vendor and said, oh, Philip Drexel, that he doesn't want to come back. That's because the VA was working with the vendor in order to cover up the Charmaine McPherson abuses of veterans that has been ongoing for quite some time, and they think they're getting away with this. We're going to court. Thank you. Bye-bye.
People, here's your governor with a message for you, and you should listen to it because it happened to me.
But discrimination isn't always that obvious. Sometimes more subtle, but in many ways more insidious. And institutionalized discrimination that's hidden behind a smiling face.
Je suis français. Mon nom est Philippe Edouardis. I'm French. I'm a French green card guy. My name is Dr. Philippe Edouardis. I'm a veteran, and I'm a green card guy. Is that okay? Because the African Americans in the offices of those elected officials have been marginalizing immigrants. And I'm about to prove it in court. and they even betrayed their own African Americans. Those are the facts, and those facts are irrefutable. Just a French green card guy.
I just wanna fuck. Yeah. I just wanna fuck. I just wanna fuck. Yeah. I just wanna fuck. I just wanna fuck.
Yeah. She takes it all. I get it all. She likes it all. I give it raw. She talk it right. I wanna buy. Don't be shy tonight. We can leave on the lights. If she wanna nasty, then I give it to her. If she wanna kinky, then I give it to her. Penetrate deep, yeah, run it right through her. No bullshit, yeah, I give it all to her. Yeah, she whispers in my ear and tells me that she's soaking wet. So I make sure I give her a pound and then she won't forget. She
boy, right here on the 161st Street, across from the barber shop. Bro, I've been giving cigarettes away to black people in the neighborhood since I got here. That's the last one I got. I can't give you no more. White boy, what is this? I'm not filming you. Just put your voice on. Because, no.
I don't want nothing to do with
you. No, all right then, what?
Don't film me. I don't want to be on YouTube.
You don't want to be on YouTube. Do you look like you're on YouTube?
Can I just say...
Does it look like you're on YouTube?
Can I say, Dreis, we thought you were dead. That's it.
Oh, fuck
that's
that.
Yeah. We thought...
What? They don't mind, sir. Yeah, do you see yourself there?
We thought the man got you, that guy.
Them motherfuckers tried to kill my black ass.
Obama gonna come here and shoot your ass.
Put that away.
All right, put it away.
We thought the man got you, Dreis.
The fuck? Hello, everybody. This is Dr. Phil Dreis and Robert Huntley. We're here with two homeless guys, but guess what? We haven't given up. We're not freaking failures. We're people. We're human.
Senator of Shirley Huntley, State Senator, New York State Senator Shirley Huntley. Oh, I love my mother and 113th of a crooked cop motherfucker that ruined my life and, you know, and a stink pussy fucking bitch. You know, along with that, you know, that pretty much I loved her. She knew that. And I don't see how she cannot help me at this point in my life. Now, my mother has pretty much not turned her full back on me, but has let me have it, you know, really, you know, to a sense that It's my fault that of my health condition, because I drove her into a nervous condition, and that's all bullshit. I love my mother from the bottom of my heart. I love Inspector, Deputy Inspector Tommy Lawless, who died, Mommy's right-hand friend and PD, and Deputy Inspector Philip Erickson. And, you know, I have let 113th and 103 off the hook with whatever I feel.
Show them the bruises on you.
They have ruined me.
Show the bruises on you you got when you went over there and your brother beat you up. This is right here. This is State Senator Huntley's son, Robert Huntley. He was beat up by his brother, who's a New York NYPD, and told not to come back home again. That's betrayal. That's treason. There's no sense for this. That's treason. But we're two homeless guys. We're buddies. And guess what? We're going to fight the fight.
I've been homeless for the last 20 motherfucking years, where I thought I was like a white, black Jimi Hendrix. You know, where, you know, the guitar on my back and whatnot. But at this point in time, I'm 54 fucking years old. And this is bullshit.
And today's Sunday, September 26th.
Yes, it is.
And it's right now 7:40.
As far as Mayor Bloomberg is concerned, the New York Senate, the Congressional Committee is all full of shit. Because me and this man have legitimate evidence and what have you. And I have sued PD and fucking won. But this is bullshit, goddammit. This is what the fuck it is, you know, goddammit. And, you know, any righteousness through God that sent his only begotten son down here. Fuck with his denomination, his abomination of making this motherfucker and then turning his goddamn back on it. It's fucking bullshit. Why the hell did his only son begotten son have to come down here and fuck with this and
now,
be tortured
now,
by goddamn fucking
Jews?
Before
we run out of time, Robert. Now, when I gave you that fly, you saw your mother's name on it. You called her.
Yes, I did.
And then when you talked to her and you asked her, was I the guy that supposed to put the death threat or anything crazy like
no,
that?
No, you were not. No, Ma denied that. It was not Dr. Philip Dreiss.
It was somebody else.
Fuck,
I have nothing to do with anything
state,
like
who
that.
Who had state police and a local 113th cop who held my hand one night. I was going to alcohol withdrawal. Another nice-looking balding cop. Yeah. I talked about like dogs, that precinct. But yeah, they did ruin my fucking life along with that stink fucking cunt hoe, Chantel Hassad Dubra. And she is full of shit. And,
now, when you spoke to her, did she knew about this case about New York City Housing Authority and all that nonsense with me?
She knew about it. She knew about it 100%, but her aides were handling the case, at which point they did not let my mother in on what's happening.
And now
she's trapped. They intercepted this man's legitimate interfucking-mation by through aid. You know, like all politicians go. Not all politicians get their mails read and received by aides and do whatever the fuck they want with it. God damn it. Kiss my fucking ass.
Bruh, we done here, man. I'm gonna go ahead and go to my mom's house in Howard Beach, and my mom gonna give me some money. I got my bedroll right here. Everybody can see. This is the bedroll. This is what I sleep on. Robert, I swear to God, I got another.
I want to bring that up on the internet. What do I, what
it's on the fly I gave you. I got another one to give you.
The abuse of veterans at the Cromwell safe haven site. That's the video that got me locked up in the VA psych ward. Misuse of mental hygiene laws. We're going to have to take it to court. Sorry. I was made homeless again. Somebody's going to pay a price. Very wrong. And this is the homeless man competition video. This really ticked them off. Cost me too much. Bye. And they did it again at the VA. Thanks. Bye. But what's more important is this. The complaint against Charmaine McPherson.
And each other to 411 on Food Drop Kick Tuesday.
Who am I thinking about? You, Genesis. Look. You see this traffic right here? You see how slow this is going? You sit in this car right now. We get out in this car. We get out in this car, and we dance right in the middle of the street. We dance right in the middle of the street. Show you how happy I am. Come on now. What? I gotta take you to one of my young boy parties. What? I've been hanging out. See them little kids down there? Yeah, that's that future thing. I'm kind of like a little bit too young. They're like really getting to too many children right away. But that's in the car. You know that daughter you want? I give it to you. You want a daughter? All right. Yeah. Okay, you're a Queens girl, Queens guy, coming back home from vacation. It was a one month excursion for the French green card guy. And what I got is worth $1 million, but it ain't the $7.3 million you want to watch me fight for in New York State Supreme Court Tuesday morning, the 30th of October, 2012. Michael Sadisky. Representing New York State Attorney General Eric T. Schneiderman, I'm whooping him, and I want you to watch. Charles Carey, representing the Mayor, Councilman Comrie, and the city agencies, you ain't got nothing to say. And I'm taking your memorandum of law, I'm making it the forward of my book, and guess what? I'm gonna have my girl countersign under you as me jacking it from you. Hey, how you doing? I don't care where you go, day or night. There's only one thing happening right now. It's me taking you. And handing your behind to my girl as a trophy in this litigation. Every single one of you guys. Bye-bye. Can you see me? Okay. This is Dr. Phil Dreis, and it's Columbus Day, and I'm hanging out with my number one best friend. And it's really strange when people are becoming friends and it takes courage It takes courage to be strong, to work through uncomfortable moments. Those can happen. Take a look. Take a look at the future of a mouth. Nice! Look, she gave me a look earlier. God, look at that beauty. Look at, isn't that a pretty one? Absolutely drop-dead gorgeous pretty one. My Christy Brinkley in New York City. To all my fans out there on YouTube, Twitter, Blogger, MySpace, and Facebook, this is a private video, just archiving my life, okay? And let's see.
Thank you.
Cinderella.
Yeah.
I'm with Cinderella. How could I not be the happiest guy in the world? Have a nice Columbus Day. Bye-bye. Hey, everybody. This is Dr. Phil Dreis. And wow. I'm out of the Bronx, and I want to introduce y'all to my girl. My number one super best friend. I'm going to marry a woman. It's going to be her. She's 24 years old. She's absolutely gorgeous. And she thinks I'm the next best thing to a bread slicing machine. And she's very afraid because she thinks I'm a dangerous individual. And she's very, very angry about just me getting locked up at the VA hospital. But I want her to say hi. I'm on the job. I gotta sneak in here because her boss don't like me. What?
Nothing.
What's your name? What's your name? You see this pretty woman right here? Let me give you a close-up.
See?
Go ahead, show them the eyes, baby. Come on now. You be hiding them. Come on now. Okay, guess what? Everybody at the Bronx VA hate you. You know why? Because I talk about you. They despise you. Regina hates you. She came on the psych ward switching her ass in front of me. There's this woman, I don't know if she's a doctor or a nurse or nurse practitioner. Her name is Fauna Baptiste. But you know what? I want you to say hi to David.
Hi, David.
All right, David. Guess what? That's Miss Genesis. That is the Primo Cinderella. Okay? Primo Cinderella. If I'm going to have a wife, I'm going to have children. There have never been any other candidate. That's why I ain't got none. So guess what? What do you want from me? Tell me what you want from me. Don't say nothing. You want me to be a nice guy. You don't want me to be dangerous. You don't want me to go beat up people in court. You just want me to concentrate on other things, yes or no? Look, she will not cooperate with this interview. What? What? Miss Genesis is my Valium. I don't need no goddamn medication from the freaking VA. If I want to be freaking calm, put her in the freaking room. You understand that? Nothing on this planet
this entire universe means more to me than she does. What? You want to see the meaning of perfection? What are you doing? Baby, I'm trying to do an interview here. Okay, put your feet back up here one more time. Go ahead. That's called perfection. Okay? So, Fauna Baptiste, Dr. Julia Golia, Dr. Schick, Dr. Tobias, everybody. Miss Genesis is my Valium. If I want Depakote, that's Depakote. If I want lithium, that's lithium. If I want anything, bingo. And guess what? I just want her to be the mother of my children. I ain't never want to marry nobody. I don't want to do shit. I went out to the United States of America because I've been tortured here. The only person that can make me look stupid, eat my words, suck shit, Miss Genesis. Are we done here? You guys have a nice day because my precious commands my obedience, and I can't curse. I can't be no bad guy. I can't shit. So, guess what?
Almost got that booty on that machine.
What's up, brother? What? What booty on the machine? Yo, let me see. Do I have permission? I'm going to go check out the booty on the machine. How am I looking?
Am I taking a
picture? No. I'm already on video. No, I just want to see. No, tell me if you can see it from over here. Am I shooting it?
No, you ain't shooting shit. What happened?
What? Let me help you.
Now you shooting.
Oh shit, you ain't shit. Let me tell you something. Can I make a confession on camera? I'm in love with you. Hello. Goodbye. Bye-bye.
All right, we just met a nice couple that was walking on the beach. Very interesting affair. This union thing. Well, everybody knows I'm a real selfish little individual, and I really like myself, and so, I'm going to offer the gentleman and the lady an opportunity to see that my book's coming out and I want y'all to buy it. I had two people so far tell me yesterday that they were going to buy my book. But right now what I really wanted to impress upon you is the depression, the pain, the loneliness, and how without a desire, a will, a drive, do nothing but to get revenge on the other. You wanted to tell the marshal when he came to get me to give me your regard. Well, what did you do when you had all of the information that says that Niger is as crooked as the tips of the Nazi cross? State Senator Huntley, Monica Pringle and Lester News are absolutely terrific for crying out loud. They're so good. But why contain it in your office? It couldn't go to Albany. Because you don't want me to get hold of the information on the federalization when the $500 million tax-free bond issue that went to the rich, and you didn't earmark anything for the people in public housing so that they can have a stake and to get out of public housing. You want them to go to this? You want them to go to this? Is this what you want for them? Well, I was born rich. I've always had everything. I don't need anything, and I don't need anybody. I don't need anything on. I'm happy right here. I feel like the T-Shot goes down. You mean to tell me I got to the point to where Dr. Dreis litigated all the way up to the appellate division of New York State Supreme Court, and everybody says like frozen in time and space. Okay, well,
Why don't I include you in the case and let your professor have a little bit more attention they want to pay to me?
Good morning. It's October 27, 2012. And we know about the bad guy character I play so well. Not convincing. Well, here we are. I got my towel in hand. Got my toothbrush. And guess what? We're going to attend to personal hygiene for the morning. There goes the police. They don't want me. I don't have a problem. I happen to be that person right there. And my toiletries bag. I got my toothpaste. Got my backpack. Got my top up. And there's a lot of things I'd like to care about. I'd love to care about a whole lot more. I'd like to care about Mrs. Green more, because having saved her life cost me my life, total destruction of my life. But I got a little secret I want to tell you. And this goes out for the Volunteers of America staff at Cromwell House. That goes for Dwayne and Greg, those guys. I'd like to care, but my give-a-damn's busted. You guys, I told you. See, this guy, I showed him to you yesterday. He's 87 years old. He's here working out every morning. So, guess what? Let's go ahead and go and understand the meaning of being out in the wild and living like an animal. You got to have other animals as pets. And here are my pets. Here are my pets. These are the seagulls. There you go, right there. There are my dollars, right there. Look at them fly. Look at them fly. Woo! Look at them, huh? Isn't that beautiful? Yep. This is how I'm living, people. And this is how I was living before I stayed at this Volunteers of America transient housing for veterans. And those guys are pretty good at what they do. Just that the people are kind of like, very abusive. Bingo. Hey, we got water. Good morning, everybody. Today is October 27, 2012, and we're just now seeing the first signs of Sandy coming to shore, because it was really calm this morning. I've given you some footage, and look at the breakers now. The breakers are coming in, but guess what? I'm walking on the beach, and guess what? Somebody lost something. Hey, how you doing? Now, everybody knows what I do out here. I do commentaries. I'm an independent journalist. And guess what? Dr. Dress has found something really special, because what? Bang! It's called a tampon. What is a tampon doing lost on the beach? You're supposed to take that home with you, because it's supposed to be tucked in. Come on now. Damn! You guys give me so much material. But the reason why I'm here right now, I'd like to make this a serious part of this footage, is that I'm here to show my friend, a wonderful lady, a nurse, these breakers, and that I'm going to be seashell hunting for her. Oh my God, they destroyed the seashell beds! Look at those guys over there with the tractors! They're killing the seashell beds! Oh, come on now. Well, I'm going to find Regina a couple of seashells. But these are the breakers coming in, ladies and gentlemen. Sandy is here. Look at these breakers, huh? Come on now. You mean to tell me there isn't adventure in living on the beach? You suffer a little bit, so what? But the reward's exponential. Wow. Look at that. That's a shell from a 12-gauge shotgun. The breakers of Sandy are coming in. Come on now, hey! This is the first sign of Sandy that we've seen on the news today. Why are you getting it from me first? You don't have anybody live on the beach like this with Channel 7, CBS, NBC. I bring you these breakers right here, right now. Sandy is here. And getting strong. Look at these guys. They're destroying the seashell bits. But hopefully we can find something nice. I wanted something big for Nurse Regina so she can put, I don't know, her jewelry in, stuff like that. I'm right here. Let me show you my pets. Here we go right there. Fly, baby, fly. Go ahead now, go ahead. Bang. At the water's edge. At the water's edge. Woo! You know how you know you're bipolar? You got two penises. Woo! Wanna check it? Have you a nice freaking day. Bye-bye.
Got to pay back. Revenge.
Hi there. We just want to talk about how happy I am that I just had a conversation with Dr. Julia Golia. And I ventilated on her. Now, what is it about me that scares so many people? I don't take no shit. Not even from the VA. You guys been bullying veterans around for a long time. And you guys at the Bronx VA been using Charmaine McPherson to do it. And you'll do it to the weak, the poor, and the freaking defenseless that are homeless vets at the Cromwell Safe Haven site. Now, what I've got is breach of confidentiality. Somebody's going to have to own up to how did I become homeless, how I got put out. After I was in prison for a week. And then you got a patient rep named Carmen asking me, well, weren't you treated well? Treated well like what? You had me in prison. And there's a place at Fort Benning where they have this escape and evasion training. How'd you like what I used on you? You guys are in a lot of trouble, and you should be. I'm sending it to the Inspector General and the White House, and I'm going to take your ass to court in case they don't want to do nothing. That's the VA and Volunteers of America. Bye-bye. Personal log 4. What's today's date? You know today's date? Mm-hmm. Today's date?
26th.
It's the 26th of November. Thank you very much, sir. 26th of November. Well, guess what? I busted the governor, Andrew Cuomo, the mayor of New York, Michael R. Bloomberg, Congressman Meeks, New York State's a Huntley. I got her locked up. State Senator Malcolm Smith, he's a real estate crook. Assemblywoman Vivian Cook, she's got cancer and not telling it. And she should be impeached because when she went to chemo, she should have transferred power. Councilman Leroy Comey, he's the head of the Black Mafia, it is alleged, to the Democratic Club. And guess what? I'm celebrating busting the VA. Nice. Because I'm quitting smoking because I want it, not because you got me locked up and giving them patches. Bye, you're busted, Bronx VA. And Brooklyn VA, you in a lot of trouble. St. Albans VA, you too. But Dr. Boykin, he ran like a coward because he's a black guy. And under his watch was two hanging noose attacks. He ran. Let's see if the VA can find him. Bye.
This is a supplemental log for Friday, March 25th, 2011. This is the continuing saga of all of the plotters against me that helped destroy my life. This segment is exclusively for Judge Maria Ressos and the two other judges prior to her that I have known, just like I knew three chairmen of housing. And everybody would like to give a shout out to Miss Daniela. I think her YouTube name is Foxfly. She made a lot of wonderful suggestions. And I don't have to be such a wretched, melodramatic, think I'm an actor guy, other than just present the facts and the evidence as they are. I'm angry, I'm all of that, but that's for another time, another situation. This is about presenting the facts, recording it, in case something happens to me. This is the judgment in order of Judge Maria Ressos. Okay? And respondents ordered to show cause to restore this proceeding to the calendar, and the motion by Stephen S. Weintraub to be removed as guardian ad litem are consolidated for determination. In rendering this decision, the court considers the respondents ordered to show cause, petitioner's affirmation in opposition, respondents reply affirmation, and petitioner's surreply only. The court acknowledges receipt and did read respondent Philip Dreis's ex parte submissions. However, as they were ex parte, they cannot be considered by the court as it reaches its decision. That's what the problem is, because my guardian ad litem, Mr. Stephen Weintraub's hands were tied. This is a gentleman where I absolutely abused him, humiliated him, degraded him, blasted crap all over him, all over the internet, in front of everybody, all the way to the White House. He filed papers against the court, to the court against me. Judge Maria Rasos brought a big cop in there. I'm not violent. I don't need to do anything like that. I'm a pretty educated guy. I know what to do and what my limits are. But that shenanigan, that show, that performance that was calculated and performed did accomplish my goal. I finally got him to work for me instead of working for human resources to put me out, as you've seen in the last segment. And that's how it works. You've got, this is a war of the intellectuals against poor people who don't have an education. And it can be traced to a race-based situation, because the people they're dealing with are the disenfranchised that have been apartheid on a federal reservation, which is the largest Indian reservation, the most populated Indian reservation in the United States of America, which is New York City Housing Authority, with approximately 800,000 tenants. But only 500 of them are registered, and those 300 are supposed to be in line to inherit that apartment, and it's the elimination of the administrative process that leads to the federal violations of diverting funds and Title VI violations, okay, under the Civil Rights Act of 1967, which is you're doing it to black people, you're doing it to Puerto Ricans, you're doing it to the disenfranchised, you're doing it to poor people that the federal government through Congress said that they take care of. But it was through the Clinton administration, it is alleged, that it was through the Clinton administration's desire to eliminate welfare that your governor was probably the premier architect who unleashed NYCHA, who dissolved any competent oversight, just like the regulators of the banks. It's been shown that the Democratic Party or the Democrats did orchestrate this big thing about this housing bubble. Okay? And they forced banks to make loans that they knew were going to fail. And then they want to blame somebody else for those bank failures and that all of that money that went down the tube. But it was designed to keep them in power. And when you're in power, you can keep cover things up. Okay? So this is what's happening, people. And in the Sir reply, let me show you here where this guy says it's his... I'll read it, you know, you'll get it in the book and online, okay? You've got NYCHA committing perjury in this document right here. This is a Sir reply. NYCHA commits perjury. Let me show you where. First of all, they said you got to be over 62 years old to be living there. And that I was the only one that was living in that apartment that was in that development. Now we find out that's not true. And when we find out that's not true, the judge want to give them exemptions. You can't go back. Okay? Here we go right here, which is Carol Brookins. Carol Brookins was living there before she turned 62. Okay? They didn't want to count that one. Let me give you another one. We're going to get Barbara. Barbara Davidson. Barbara Davidson is the sister of Margaret, who works for Councilman Comrie. And when it got this bad, Barbara Davidson right here, when it got this bad, they got her to move out of Shelton House. That's how big it is. Barbara Davidson had Davidson's been living there for 30 years. She didn't take the buyout, just like my aunt didn't take the buyout. That's why we were still in that apartment.
They want to make it senior development, but they were supposed to give you $15,000. Okay? Now, this is the big deal right here. This is Mr. James Edwards in apartment 6N. He's got a Michelle Guy who lives there. She was born in 1976. What is she doing living there? He was born in 1947. Now, you see, he's got a son and a daughter. A son and a daughter right there. Now, that's where the fraud comes in. Because in the paper, NYCHA reclassified him as a grandson, not a son. And the judge copied the exact same stuff. That's what I'm going to hit her with, along with the trial transcript of where NYCHA said nobody under 62 lives there. Now, here is the beauty. This is Cynthia Hill, okay, with her husband, Babako, okay? She was born in 55, he was born in 66. But you got to understand, the lease, I've got it on video, that she said that they put him on the lease 3 years ago. That's another point of perjury for NYCHA in the settlement of the minutes or the transcript. Okay? That's how they're all busted. Just presenting the facts. Just presenting the facts. Thank you, Daniela. Thank you. Yeah. Supplemental log, November 29, 2010. This is Miss Cynthia Hill, the last real tenant association president that there was. They fixed the vote. Khadijah Wilson fixed the vote to put Neva Harper in there. And guess what, ladies and gentlemen? This is the evidence that right now we've got everybody committing perjury in court because you're not a senior citizen. You live there, and your husband's name was added on to the lease, what, 2 years ago? So now when they put me out, weren't they doing a whole lot of wrong?
Yeah.
And Neva Harper, they propped her up as tenant association president so she can help eliminate people out of that building as a form of redlining.
Yes. She has a handicap apartment. She's not handicapped.
And so does Ozia Mitchell, who was also the last tenant association president that they put there to help.
Green of $20,000.
Oh, Cynthia Hill, former tenant association president, November 29, 2010, telling it like it is. That's my sister. And this is the one. That's right. I want my picture with her. This is the lady. This is the lady that helped me.
Right. Fight that.
Fight the fight. This is the one that kept telling me, Dryce, don't let them put you out like this. Don't do this. And I went and did my work. And that's Malcolm right there. He's the one that's helping put people out.
Yes, he is.
And that's the tenant associate president telling it. That's what they do here. Right here at 8909 162 Street at Shelton Houses, New York City Housing Authority. There it is right there. You heard it from the tenant association president, Cynthia Hill. Thank you, baby. All right, this is my friend. What's your name? You gotta say your name.
Marvin.
Hi, Marvin. Good. Make the snowball. Yeah, he's under supervision. He's here with his dad. I'm not trying to kidnap the child. It's not a kidnapping. All right. So how's your wife? Your wife okay?
Yeah, she's okay.
She works. Mother okay? She's working? Yeah, she told me she got a job as a home attendant.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Her mother's upstairs?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah, this is Marvin. You live upstairs, right, Marvin?
Yeah.
Okay, throw the snowball. There he is. That's it. That's it. Okay. You waiting on the school bus? You waiting on the school bus? You waiting for the school bus, right? All right. All right.
Can I please have a dollar? Somebody can have a quarter, 50 cent a dollar. I'm homeless. I'm broke. I'm hungry. Please, can somebody help me? Can somebody help me? I'm homeless. I used to live right across the street over there. Go ahead, show them Shelton House. Shelton, that's that building right there. The one with the scaffolding. That's it. I used to live at Shelton House. But now I'm homeless. I'm homeless. I've got no money. I got nothing to eat. Can somebody help me? Can somebody help me? Is there a God? There can't possibly be a God or he couldn't let this happen to me. Those black politicians in America destroyed me. And no one was worth a damn thing to help me. All right, we just met a nice couple. I was walking on the beach. Very interesting affair. This, who wanted to tell the marshal when he came to get me, to give me your regard. Well, what did you do when you had all of the information that says that Niger is as crooked as the tips of the Nazi claws?
The plan calls for them transitioning 8,400 of their NYCHA units into the Section 8 program. All of the state-funded NYCHA buildings, if you add up the amount of units in all of them, equates 8,400. There are 21 of those buildings. The ones that affect Harlem are Manhattanville, Frederick Samuels, and Drew Hamilton. When you look at the details of the plan, let's say that you move out of the building altogether for whatever reason, it has nothing to do with this program. That building, that apartment is going to turn into a Section 8 apartment. If you sign for the voucher, now this goes beyond, you know, being on the waiting list for to try to get the voucher or even filling out the application. Once they say, okay, we will give you this Section 8 voucher. So once you sign that contract for the voucher, you transition that apartment into the Section 8 program. This special program is not the same type of Section 8. They have different nuances that, you know, are different than the normal Section 8. One of the things that they have to lure you in, and I think this is like to lure you in, is that they're waiving the background check, the criminal background check, and the income verification for 6 months. Now you know that you've never heard of that before, you know? So obviously they're trying to get everybody, you know, to take this so they can transition these apartments. But now when it is time for them to do the income verification and the background check and you don't qualify, guess what? You're out, okay? You're gonna lose your subsidy and you can't, it doesn't go back to being in the NYCHA, you know, apartment pool. It's a Section 8 apartment, so you're gonna have to leave, period. That's another thing. Once you sign the voucher, you can't change your mind. You can't, like, 2 weeks later say, okay, never mind, I don't want to do this. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a done deal. Now, there'll be all kinds of ways. These are the various scenarios that people need to realize that, let's say, for example, you sign for the voucher, okay? Let's just say now, under Section 8, that your household size is too small for the apartment that you're living in, mm-hmm. okay? So they may want to downsize you, not may, they will. If they can't find an apartment in that particular development where you come out of, you're not going into one of the other 20 available apartments if they have any. You're going to go into a federal building, okay? Now, who do they bring in aside from the people living there in these developments? And these people come from a special list. HUD has a special list that I'm sure they're going to share with NYCHA. They have the complete profile of who these people are. Okay, they've already been, you know, from reliable sources, they've been showing the apartments already to potential tenants, and none of them look like really. They're put it this way: they're different. They're everything but African American so far. I would say don't sign the voucher. There are people out there that are now becoming up, you know, they're getting up to speed on what's happening. with this plan. So they'll have all the information, and they really need to know what they're getting into. You know, so it's going to look good, you know, because they're making it look really good, all right? But don't go by what NYCHA is presenting to you. That's what I'm saying. Because when, you know, I mean, when can you really truly trust? Look at what's happening with Harlem, period, you know, with the 125th Street rezoning, the Columbia expansion plan, and our local government failed us. So can we really trust the agencies that are headed by Bloomberg appointees? And the answer is no. So I would say don't sign the voucher. Really, you know what this program is really all about. Know it very well. And then if it benefits you, okay, you know, it could, there's a possibility it could benefit some people, then go ahead and, you know, and sign for it. But I'm saying that it's not going to really benefit the majority of the tenants. Well, they can contact me at the provided email. And also a lot of community groups like Maribel Sisters. You're going to have Coalition to Preserve Community. Nellie Bailey at the Harlem's Tenants Council. There's some other on that list. But then the Manhattanville Tenants Association, okay, they're going to be up to speed. The Drew Hamilton Tenants Association, they're going to be up to speed. I can't speak offhand just yet about Frederick Samuels, but I know Drew Hamilton's Tenants Association, they're going to be up to speed on this. Manhattanville. And we're trying to now, you know, get this message out to the other developments in the other boroughs. So this is information that we're trying to disseminate. Why? We're all living in America. America is wunderbar. We're all living in America. 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 Wenn ihr tanzt, wird will ich führen. Auch wenn ihr euch allein.
Speaker number four, Philip Price, please come forward.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to thank you and I congratulate you.
Thank you.
You are the most articulate and the most charming chairman of the four chairmen that I've known. Ladies, isn't he a good-looking guy? Just a good-looking guy. Okay? Now, we're going to be real nice to Mr. Rhea.
Did my mother pay you to say that?
No. This guy did, the housing whistleblower.
Okay, all right.
I'm that guy.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, I spoke to Constance Robitaille. This retaliation against me to destroy my life, can it please stop? I'm a remaining family member. Right now, I've been beating up Byron Metakakis in Supreme Court so bad, this is for you. I just beat him up that
fast. Yeah, okay. So. You should move to the next one.
Mr. Chairman, I have 1 minute and 40 seconds. Three things. Number one, the retaliation against the whistleblower. If an old lady is embezzled by an employee out of $20,858, Ricardo Elias Morales calls my boss, who I work for at a law firm, and tell me to tell them to leave alone. I left them alone, but you don't leave the old lady in your apartment with the gas stove on for 4 hours, and then you orchestrate a retaliation scheme against me with a containment apparatus that destroyed my life, cost my business over $4.5 million, $100,000 for antiques taken out of my home. I'm a Haitian French Orthodox Roman Catholic. I leave people alone. I don't bother anybody. But the kind of compassion that it takes to see what I'm seeing is just humane. It's nothing special. Another thing, criminal neglect. I don't understand this. You mean to tell me you got two lawyers in two different courts and both of them have a different story about an supposed exclusive senior development that is not? Another one. When you deceive the judges, you deceive the courts, and I bring that to you. The Veterans Administration asked Congress to speak to call in state and federal law enforcement. Ida Smith says, you even got a call recently about May Keys, where they said NYCHA is conducting a form of redlining. Those 21 developments, I believe, were part of the Davis versus NYCHA, that it was found that NYCHA was conducting a form of redlining. Are we still on the same page here? And I'm done.
Mr. Price, we'll have somebody come over and speak to you. Okay, specific to your concerns. Speaker number five, Carmen Quinones.
Hi, how are you?
Mike's coming.
But I am from Douglas Houses. First, I want to tell you, welcome.
Thank you.
I'm sorry that you're getting beat up, but NYCHA has done so much to people that we don't know who to believe anymore, which is sad. I want to tell you that, though, Gloria, hi, because you have always been very helpful to me. And Margarita Lopez, always there, presente. But what I want to tell you is that there are so many things wrong that people don't want to believe anything. Mm-hmm. That's where we're at here. I think that your presentation, beautiful. But even to get here, I couldn't even get down because my elevator was broke. So I had to come down 15 steps, get on the train, and come to see you, baby.
Okay. All right. So, listen, go ahead. I'm sorry.
After my 2 minutes, you can tell me whatever you want.
I thought it was about elevator.
My concern is that we have a lot of seniors in our development. A lot. We also have a lot of youth. They don't know what to do. They have nothing to do, so they're lottery. They're hanging. Our seniors are scared to come out. They're scared to come out. These developments have become hazardous. Your elevators, I am so tired of them coming and putting a Band-Aid on that elevator and that Band-Aid falling off in 2 seconds. So I understand where you're going, and I know that we need the money because we too are underfunded in our development. We need more maintenance workers, and I hear you. All I'm just asking you is to bear with them, bear with everybody here, because everybody is not going to be nice. But I just want you to know that I'm here for you. We're here for you.
Dr. Joyce, I'm in downtown Jamaica. This is in front of the Coliseum. Let me go see one of my boys. The policeman over here, that's what I suspect. Oh, there, my boy right here. What's happening? I'm good.
A long time no see and everything.
Yeah, man, I've been hiding out from the police.
Oh, yeah, because they had you all around in the papers as wanted or something. I don't know what happened.
They had me wanted in the paper.
Yeah.
They've been showing it around.
All these stores out here.
They went to every store.
That's why I know you married. I told them, no, I've never seen you.
You're goddamn right. You know what I do? Now, have I been spending my money, my life, and everything helping everybody in this community?
Since I know you, since first time I saw you, you had that.
The Segway. That's got to be at least 5 years.
More than that.
Yo, man, this destroyed my life. The congressman orchestrated a death threat against himself and had the DA's office hunting me. I got interviewed with the people from the library that they had undercover cops. Plain homeless. Even when I was homeless, did I ever look homeless?
The police right there. Today is June 5th, 2011. There goes the police right there. Right now we're in front of the library. We're talking to one of my friends here because we're homeless people. Like, I am a homeless guy. We are homeless, okay? And I know I can go stay with my mom, my Russian mom in Howard Beach, but they had exiled me out the ghetto. What do I do around here? I make everything go when I'm selling the boat, don't I?
Yeah.
That's right. That's what I do around here. Now tell me your story about the homelessness right here, and then tell me about the detectives. So tell me about the detectives coming over here looking for me. Stay right there, stay right there.
The last one, once the detectives will come here, in and out the library, they have regular NYPD outside, they have the undercover homeless hang out at the library.
Uh-huh.
I will come in and out. I just got...
They even had cops that were playing homeless, hanging out in the library.
Yep.
Undercover cops that were playing homeless in the library. Who were they looking for?
You.
That's right. And did they tell y'all why?
Nope.
But don't you think it must have been a pretty big deal for them to orchestrate such a big deal for one little guy? Just me. One little Haitian first green card guy.
That's me.
That be a good
nigga
in America. Can I help? Tell us what your story, bro.
I just made it in the homeless shelter, and the homeless shelter system is nowhere to be. They get ready to consolidate everything.
We're going to go to the next clip now, okay? Bye-bye.
Today is June 12, 2011. I'm going to have you listen to the audio voicemail of a detective calling from the Queens District Attorney's Office after they had tried for more than two and a half months trying to capture me and to orchestrate some fake death threat to the congressman, and everybody's busted. This is showing you the evidence that I've got. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to go call my voicemail and let's see what happens. Okay. This is the district attorney's office. This is the district attorney's office and the congressman's office getting together trying to kill me.
You have one unheard message. First unheard message.
I don't want the unheard message.
Message skipped. First skipped message.
I'm hoping.
Yeah, that's my mother calling.
Message skipped. Message.
This is Philip Drive. This is the officer here from the NYPD. Please give me a call when you get a chance. 718-765-4333. Thank you.
Alright. He may be taking the hit for the district attorney's office as a sacrificial lamb. I can't let that happen. District attorney, you are busted, Mr. Brown. You have command responsibility. For such a case to have gotten this far, this big, undercover cops playing homeless in the library, then you've got people going all over the Coliseum and the Coliseum Mall street, door-to-door merchants showing them my picture. You are hunting you a Negro, and you're trying to use Jim Crow laws to hunt you an immigrant on orders of the African-American congressman. Congratulations, you're busted. Bye.
Okay, we're going to call Sergeant Garcia.
Yeah. Oh, I think I know him.
Yeah?
He's a Marine guy, right?
I don't know. Yes, man, speak to Sergeant Garcia.
Oh, he's in the office right now.
He's not in the office? All right, this is Philip Dreis. He had been calling me and stuff. And I just want to let you guys know, I don't care what the congressman's office might have told you. I ain't no threat to nobody. Y'all sent a whole bunch of detectives all around the neighborhood, slandered my name. And I'm an ABA certified paralegal. I'm a forensic paralegal. And I ain't no threat to nobody. He might want to see that if he goes on the internet and take a look at the shows. Because whatever they...
I don't think he's looking for you in that respect. I think that
you know, what tends to happen is sometimes you have individuals who may be concerned or whatnot, and then they call us, and it's our job to make an assessment of the situation. I think if they were seriously considering looking for you, they would have definitely went out there aggressively and filed you. I think
y'all would have got me already, because I ain't turned off my phone.
I think what they have to do is, you know, they have to make contact with you, you know, so they can say that, hey, listen, we spoke to him in person, and, you know, he's fine, you know?
He scared the crap out of me, man. Detectives was looking for me. People been telling me all kinds of stuff. So, look, I just want you to know I ain't no threat to the congressman at all. I even videotaped myself going by his office saying, hey, look, I ain't no threat to nobody. I exposed things about crookedness. I've lost my business, lost $5 million. And these people did so much dirt to me, man. Y'all want to look at that. And if they filed a false police report, that's a misdemeanor. They got to get arrested. That's what I'm trying to say.
Right.
Okay. All right, brother.
All right, hey, listen, you be safe out there, man. Enjoy the beautiful weather today.
Thank you, my friend. You too.
All right.
Okay, bye-bye. Well, it just looks like we got what we wanted on the internet.
What, boy? What is this?
Don't film me, Dryas.
I'm not filming you. Just put your voice on. Because, no.
I don't want nothing to do with you.
No, all right then, what?
Don't film me. I don't want to be on YouTube.
You don't want to be on YouTube. Or do you look like you're on YouTube?
Can I just say...
Does it look good like you're on YouTube?
Can I say, Dryce, we thought you were dead. That's it.
Oh, fuck that. Cut, but what? Yeah. Ain't nobody said... do you see yourself there?
We thought the man got you, Dryce. Obama goes
them motherfuckers Obama tried to kill my black ass.
Obama gonna come here and shoot your ass.
Put that away. All right, put it away.
We thought the man got you, Dryce.
You fuck...
Good morning. Today is Thursday, Good Thursday, April 21st, 2011. I got received a call from the NYPD police detective Garcia, who wants to talk to me, which prompted this presentation. And we'll be in multiple parts. I don't know how many yet. We're just going to have to go with the numbers on that ticker over there. That's the time. I'd like to first of all start off with, I'm this guy. In New York News Day, that I went to a meeting, Tom Prater invited me to. Newsday was there. He saw Dr. Tube, the Crusader, fell in love with the product. Front page. And I believe it's the household leisure section, something like that. Now, I'm also that guy that worked for Mayor Bloomberg, volunteered for his third term, even though I testified against him at the third term hearings in order to get his attention and to stop my eviction. I'm also the guy that presented the evidence to the Attorney General. Oh, I'm sorry. He's governor now. I'm also the guy who should be very angry because this is just one part of the four parts of documents I litigated that won me two landmark judgments and awards from Justice James J. Golia, New York State Supreme Court, Long Island City. Ida Smith, three of these are missing, plus those two books to Mr. Juan Cuba at the White House. That's when this whole thing about get the police to get Philip Dry started. With Sophia King. Remember? You stopped that. You should have stopped yourself this time when you figured out I would expose you to school teacher. Thanks for this one, Ida. It's intact. One, two, landmark awards and judgments and orders. And I litigated all the way at the appellate division of New York State Supreme Court, and this is a meritorious cause of action to implead Mayor Bloomberg, the police department, the Queens District Attorney's Office, and Human Resources, and following documents. We'll show you that. And these are the documents. That's the mayor. You see that stamp right there? That's the mayor. That's the police department, NYPD. Human Resources Administration for playing me for crazy like Ida Smith did. And New York City Housing Authority, in which I had to go back and do it to New York City Housing Authority at New York City Housing Authority because the comptroller won't accept claims against them because that is federal dollars. And you people need to understand what the law is, how it works, and what the process is. But I did hear from Tom Prater, acquiesced, Trice, when I got the surreply. When I got the transcript of the trial in Supreme Court where I beat Byron Medegakis so bad before he left the courtroom, he said, I'm going to appeal. And then I taunted them and played with them right when they got out the courthouse, right around the fountain in Long Island City. I can. Those are trophies for my as my rewards. When I do this, people, I ain't got no wife. I ain't got no kids. Ain't too many people give a damn about me. I'm an ugly guy who can accept my life, my fate as it is. I am kind. I am benevolent. I am generous. And y'all turned that against me. And those are you black staffers in the offices of black elected officials. And you guys are so rotten, you make it a freaking embarrassment to be black in America. Because you were supposed to stop this when you saw it. This is a surreply that you have a Judge Maria Rezos in Queens County Civil Court plagiarizing perjuries in the surreply index number 16218-2005. Right here. Just an absolute embarrassment. This right here is the transcript of the trial. Right here. In February 2009. The General Counsel of Policy was there and he committed perjury in his transcript. That's why we have to go to federal court. This is the case that got washed out. And there you go, right there, you got to see Mayor Bloomberg's name. Bingo. All covered up and contained. This is big news. This is big news. And I depended on this guy to fix it because I put it in his hands at the St. Albans VA auditorium close to 4 or 5 years ago. That's how I ended up getting to handle Ida Smith. These are the letters that this woman's got me writing to this guy, kissing his behind, and it was an exercise in futility. What she conducted, she was part of an orchestration to obstruct justice are the allegations. Oh, winds of change. I did a political accountability documentary that aired on TV campaigning for this guy. This is a letter asking him for a meeting. At the end of the day, we know that my attorney sent this to the Elder Abuse Unit about this lady right here that got embezzled out of $20,858 and what it was earmarked to allow her to destroy herself in order to contain it. And when you steal that much money from somebody, $20,858, and you leave them in their apartment with the gas stove on, that's a Nazi copycat crime. I've been doing my activism, and I do it very nicely, thank you, with my two documentaries that aired on TV, scared every politician in town because they never seen one man do so much all by himself. That's because I'm not touching your little heifers. I put this all over town. Call your congressman and ask him, how did he cover this up? You're a black guy, you're a congressman, and you got a Native American female acting as a congressman with the kind of power with him that she rules with impunity, playing everybody's mama. Well, guess what? Fooled you, didn't I? I don't need no mama. You're embarrassed. You're humiliated. That's why you called the police and filed a false police report. I ain't no threat to you, Adam Smith. I wouldn't harm anything on you. But I have to destroy the myth of you being so honest. You have no integrity. You have no integrity. You're a liar. You're a sneak. You're like a cobra. You're that slithery. And Jason Hilliard said it. You're mad because I attacked you by the preponderance of the evidence that I blasted over the internet. And your credibility destroyed. Leave the congressman with no more shield, no more sword. He's now no longer invincible. That's what I want. By proving to everybody he covered this up, and they gave the white boy who did it a promotion. Ida Smith hooked that up. I swear on my mother's grave, because she spoke to the VA police that covered it up. With the union, she was the head boss, because it was the congressman's office and his power. The myth of his power, because he's a powerless bastard that couldn't get me to stay in the ghetto so I can help these people. That's what I did with my life. You destroyed this. You killed him. You killed him. You killed him. And the evidence also says that the guy you endorsed and campaigned for, you knew. And I think now that I'm realizing it, it looks like me reporting on my activities for him to your Ida Smith and your office was illegal, Congressman Meeks. Can we talk about what else you covered up, which is the retaliation, the guy who saved that old lady and protected her and brought to how she was embezzled and everything that was done wrong to her? Did you see her in the nursing home, Congressman? What we've got is we've got the Veterans Administration washing their hands of any liability, any culpability, anything, because they handed me a deck of cards. We had them for Saddam Hussein and everybody in Iraq, remember? Well, the VA knows all about it. And they gave me a deck of cards. And it's got the name of every politician in town. State Senator Malcolm Smith. State Senator Shirley Huntley. Congressman Gregory W. Meeks. Assemblywoman Vivian Cook. Councilman Leroy Comrie, with your Rands Huff, who hates me. Hates Haitians, because he was the first one to get the evidence. And he went to NYCHA, it is alleged. And that's how NYCHA ended up coming after me.
because I went to you first before I went to the Inspector General of NYCHA, and they was already waiting for me. Ambushed. I want time to prepare my book. That's why I'm leaving. I wrote a letter to the White House, and this is when all the trouble began, when I got this from the Justice Department, which is a White House referral number. Where is it? WH White House 0714-2010-7. That's my White House referral number. All I asked those politicians, which I just named, look, y'all been getting this information on the internet, dropping it off to your house, I'm in your functions, you got me using me to go get this guy, Heidi Smith. You're the one that told me for me to go get Malcolm Smith. And you can't pass a lie detector when you told me that he's the one that snitched on the congressman and all that stuff, and the attorney general washed his hands of it because there were boys in the Clinton administration, there was a conflict of interest, and he sent it to the feds. And now the new attorney general has sent me something from the Integrity Bureau. So at the end of the day, to round it off in this 15 minutes on YouTube, is that you are busted because I'm taking your butts to court and hear your names right there. They've been sitting there for 6 months. I don't have anything else to say. I'm not. What am I going to tell you? Other than I'm filing a notice of claim in order for me to get $75,000 because I blasted all over the internet that I'm the one who put up the Thompson pictures. So give me a break and quit, you guys. Quit your lying. Have a nice day. Bye.
Today is Tuesday, December 7, 2010. Here I am at the Brooklyn VA. Last time I was here, all medication was stopped. And right here today, we have a clean bill of health on paper. I'm a former patient. I'm not getting any medication. I'm not getting anything. And this is a recommendation to all the local officials, including Congressman Gregory W. Meeks, to respond and to refer my case to state and federal law enforcement. On to law enforcement. State and federal law enforcement, it said, and it was recommended 2 years ago. This recommendation to the congressman and Mr. Dreyse's elected officials is still in effect. It's still in effect. Outstanding. So now we're going to take this, we're going to send them to the local officials and to the Justice Department so I can get me some closure about this thing that's going on. Thank God for the Veterans Administration, I swear to God. Thank God for my people. Over here at the VA, or I'd have been screwed. And I thank Almighty God for the Veterans Administration. All right, all right. Yeah, we're winning, we're winning, we're winning. You local officials that didn't want to give me a letter saying that you got evidence, well, it doesn't make a difference. I don't have to take you to court and just beat you down like a natural born dirty dog. Which is what I would have done to you. But I would have risked embarrassing the Democratic Party and my president. That's why this document will let you off the hook. That's what I'm saying. Y'all have a nice day. Bye-bye. This is Wednesday, October 13, personal log. Here we are at the Brooklyn VA. This is Dr. Philip Edward Dreyse. Here I am. I'm that nice guy. Now we have no more medication from the Veterans Administration prescribed to Dr. Philip Edward Dreyse. I got a non-bar JD. I have an ABA certified paralegal out of Queens College. Now, why is it that I was called crazy? I was referred to the VA by the congressman's office because of stressors due to the relocation apparatus of the Bloomberg administration, in which now we've caught every single politician hand, dead cold, red-handed, and trying to get rid of me, destroy my life, to keep quiet the redlining scheme of the Bloomberg administration, in which they are in collusion with the Bloomberg administration in violation of the Constitution and the Separation of Powers Act. And they tried to use the Veterans Administration to issue me medication in order, as a chemical restraint, in order to try to say, to justify the office of Congressman Meeks behind closed doors going around saying I'm crazy along with all of the other politicians. That's Councilman Comrie, Vivian Cook's office, State Senator Huntley, and Malcolm Smith's office. I don't think the congressman had anything to do with this. I don't think the congressman had anything to do with this. Just as the son of State Senator Huntley said, a bunch of staffers got together, and all of them know each other. They went and did this behind the backs of the elected officials, but these elected officials are now trapped. They can't, what are they going to do? You think they're going to say, oh, our staffer did this, and that? No, they're going to cover for them. That's why we got to take them to court. Take everybody to court and let the judge figure out what to do with them. Thank you very much. Separation of powers. That's what's going to get you guys. Here we are at the VA. I am clear. No more medication. No more medication. No more chemical restraints to keep me from my activism to get justice in America. I am a foreigner. I'm a Haitian immigrant. And I'm a veteran. Dr. Philip Dreis out. There's no law. October 13th, 2010.
We're all living in America, America, it's wunderbar. We're all living in America, America, America. We're all living in America.
Mommy, you know I'm a nut. That's why I asked you to wait. Wow.
Your valve was dead. So
thank you.
I bought it from Philip.
Wow. This place was a mess with all the stuff you bought me.
Yeah, now you have a prince bed.
Oh, mommy. Oh, mommy. Boy, I really feel like a little prince.
Yeah, you should.
Thank you.
You have ability to be one.
Thank you, Mommy. And I thought it was going to be in another segment that I would ask you this, but now that it's Thanksgiving night, you know what I want to do. But I've been taking care of your business with such pleasure. I wanted to show off. Yeah, I want to impress you. And I love it. So, Mommy, now, you know, me and these guys have a war going on. I didn't...
What always going on?
Okay. I want to ask you something.
Between the guys, between the families, unfortunately, between loved ones, this is very sad.
Yeah, but...
Nobody can hurt you more than loved ones.
Mommy, I love the people in Congressman Meeks' office so much. I love Ida Smith. It kept me away from you. I ain't come yet. Whenever I had something nice, I'd bring it. If I couldn't see you, I'd leave it. If you call me, I'm right there.
No.
But I had
all
to...
it was for me.
But Mommy, I had to fight. I had to fight for the integrity of the inheritance from my mother to me by federal law. I had to fight for that. And that was because I saved that old lady's life and exposed the money that was stolen, that was covered up. And then it came, these guys created so many crimes. They went around the law in so many ways. And then come to find out, if it wasn't for Jason Hilliard, I would have never suspected the congressman's office. In order for me to start investigating them instead of me thinking they were my friends. And Ida Smith, damn, she was good, Mommy. Mommy, she almost convinced me that she was so good for me and that...
That she can kill you this love.
And that's what the heck she did. And the love that she had wasn't for me,
The love she had was for the protection of her boss. That's the love.
Betrayed.
I was betrayed. But I believe in her innocence. I don't think she never thought it would get this far. She never thought I'd discover. In other words, she was a bottle and I was the genie that was put in it by her being the bottle that was able to suck the fumes of my mind, my thoughts, my ideas that I put on paper and put in her hands. She worked, even a friend of mine, the guy that did her office, her partner, told Dr. Friesen, hey, you do anything with that guy, we ain't doing business with you. Even Ida Smith told me that that guy, they hooked him up, they call him doctor. And me, they call me a piece of shit.
So now I have to go for my doctors.
Mommy, you've been an RN for 45 years. You're bigger than any little doctor coming out of medical school. So what I'm thinking is,
I save a lot of lives.
You getting your,
and I'm proud of this.
Get up.
I gave a lot of love and care for people who was having sunset in life, in their life.
And what happened to my mother? You know how I would freaking kill. And in that Dry Harbor nursing home, you know they were trying to get me to do. Why would people? Anyway, I'm not going to talk bad about. Go back there. I let it go. And it's been 5.5 years since my mother died, and you've given me a new life. And she did used to give me away to a whole bunch of women. She gave me to her sister, then her sisters, then to Mrs. Lohenberg, Elizabeth Lohenberg. Then I got her. I was 25 years old, yeah, when I actually began to know and get to know and love and live with my mother and be within reach that I could see her anytime. Although I wasn't, you know, I didn't live in New York City. And anyway, I was, after I met you and complained to you about them no good pieces of crap, how they was treating my mother and taunting me and doing things that should have made me run up and hit somebody or do something inappropriate. That's the same kind of crap these little colored dudes did to me, mommy. I'm a French guy. I love everybody. You see how I get along with everybody.
You do.
But these guys,
you can't control your temper. This is what I learned too.
Oh, yes, I can. And I have a very bad one. But these guys, they're ruling by a black law. I discovered something. I discovered something that is in the fabric of the African-American community, that unless I was black like them and didn't and went in there and lived as one of them and studied them for a living, especially having my behavioral science background, my psych background, my marketing background, my legal background, my education, my anthropology education, all those educations led me to actually, yes, they're still slaves. They're still slaves, right? We're immigrants. We might have a different skin color, but we're not like them. And the chances of the likelihood of people like us coming here, even whether you're rich or poor.
But we have our morals.
Yes, principles. That's the key.
And we cannot live by American
principles.
Principles, yes.
That's why I created the moral. World Appellate Court of Good Morals and Ethics. You see, and these people can't seem to understand, because some of them said to me, like, how do I live with white people? They sure don't live like you. I've lived like you. I've been with their women, lived in their houses, raised their kids. And I don't have anything against them. I mean, I love being in my life. I was doing good, being good, because God gifted me with so much.
Ice and fire.
And these guys, they're a bunch of slavers. So guess what I'm going to do to them? I'm going to buy them money. I'm going to buy them through an index number to bring their butt cheeks to court vicariously by their attorney, because they won't have the guts to freaking show up, them freaking punk cowards, to face me and look at me in the eye and say, Dreiss, you're wrong. No, I'm not. I got you. And I got you good. And right now it's Thanksgiving. We are celebrating the harvest of my past 5 years to 7 years of work from the time I started my activism for Mrs. Franny Green. This is a happy Thanksgiving. So what I'm going to do in order to keep this on this one tape, because I still got up to 15 minutes on this, I'm going to run downstairs and introduce the rest of the family to my fans and the people that really care and love me. They really do. Because I protected them black people too, and there's a lot of black people behind me. And that's part of the jealousy of these guys. So many people like me. I'm more popular than the elected officials. And if I was an American citizen, I could make a run for their seats even at the congressional level.
Yeah, I told you you should be a congressman.
Mommy, I don't want to become an American citizen.
Why not?
Because I would be betraying the longest bloodline of free black men on this planet. Obama is a free black man because his mother was white, his father was from Africa, not having the slave legacy and lineage of the slave breeding big Negro, big Watusi, Mandingo, Miss Superfield Negro people. And their women are the men. Their women are the men. And the men are weak. They got big bodies. They can go fight in Vietnam. But they're ruled by women. They're not like...
They have no brain.
It's been abstracted to what is called the Willie Lynch chip. They're very smart, intelligent, can be all those things. But as far as the brain. So what I'm going to do to these guys, mommy... Dr. Philip Edward Dreiss is about to give you. Let me do this with my mama. It's like Obama was doing it with his mother. I am about to give you an injection. All of you. I'm talking about Congressman Gregory W. Meeks, Shirley L. Hunt, the New York State Senator, New York State Senator Malcolm A. Smith, Assemblywoman Vivian Cook, and Councilman Leroy Comrie, along with their friends. They're all the same. It's not about your luck, color, it's your position. Which is Dominic Rafter, that newspaper reporter, and Brian Rafferty. Guess what I'm going to do to you guys? I'm going to give you all an injection, and that's the nurse right there, 45 years RN. I'm going to give you an injection that will expand your mind to a point where it will never, ever, ever go back to its original smaller size. You understand that? And so guess what I got to say to you? And I can't do this in front of my mother because I respect my mother. All I've got to say to you is bang! That's what I'm talking about. There's a double dose of it. You know why? Because you need a double dose to get it through into your brain. Because I got to take care of your body and have enough to get to your brain. Because I got to expand it. Because it's been extracted to the Willie Lynch chip. And I'm going to make sure I'm going to make you free at the end of that. See, that's the reward. From what I'm going to take you to, it's like almost like when I went through escape and evasion training when I was in the 1st Ranger Battalion, 75th Infantry, at Fort Stewart, Georgia, in 1975. I'm going to teach you a lesson you guys have never seen before. Ask Adam Smith what I did to New York City Housing Authority that you guys kept contained. I'm about to do the same thing to you. And you've been harvested, and now all of you are represented as turkeys on my table. Okay? Now.
Woo! You're not going to cut them. You're going to rip them off.
Yes, Mommy. And guess what? As they are dissected on paper, I promise to harvest the butt cheeks, the big Watusi Mandingo mixed Superfield Negro butt cheeks. You know, they have great-looking butt cheeks. We're going to get their butt cheeks. The rectum will be attached. The descending colon. The traverse colon. The stomach cavity. The ascending colon. Attached will be their esophagus. I got to do that, Mommy. I got to do that because they disrespected me. They acted as if my culture was inferior to theirs, Mommy. And they're giving a bad example to them. They're giving a bad example to your people. You guys are not leaders. You guys are slavers. So I'm going to do what I'm going to do to you. What you've destined for your people to be enslaved under you. Now I'm going to make you defendants under me.
by vicarious liability, you will become my indentured servant. Because I'm going to sue each and every single one of you for at least $1 million, and the newspaper, $10 million, and Tom Credit, you ain't got no money. Don't you remember me? I'm the guy that used to work for $10 an hour, come and clean your goddamn toilet. Showing you where to take your clothes to get washed, where to take them for your white shirts to be white, to be pressed, for you to look like a real corporate executive. You're my student. Now you graduate. Free. Free. You're free. Because what you were teaching me, I don't want to learn. How to keep my mouth shut, stay good down and under, and give it up to these guys. Those are your boys, Tom Crady. Those are your boys. You're a newspaper editor and publisher. You're the one that told me about Detective Bernie Porter. Come on, man. Come on, man. To the district attorney's office. Come on. All I know is, I thank everybody. It's time for Thanksgiving. It's a little bit too freaking private for me to show you all my freaking table and my plate. Why? Next year, you'll probably come here and try to rob me. You know what I mean by that. Bang! That's what I'm talking about. Bang! A double dose of what you like. Bang! Three strikes, you're out, buddy. Bang! Get out of here. Ciao.
This is the personal law for Thanksgiving Day. This is Pop over here doing some work on the door. This guy can do anything, and he's a perfectionist. I know it, his wife knows it, and that's a great thing. I'm learning a lot. And this is in fact very therapeutic for Philip Dreis. I'm being constructive, I'm doing things, I'm fitting into my normality. My hate, anger, and rage have subsided. I don't hate these people and what they did to me, but I wanted to say happy Thanksgiving to Congressman Meeks. I wanted to say happy Thanksgiving to Congressman Leroy Thomas. I wanted to say happy Thanksgiving to all of you people who have done so much to destroy my life. Hi, how you doing?
Bang!
That's what I got to say to you.
Bang!
A double dose. Wow. Today is the day that you're going to remember for a very long time. You know why? Because today is November 25th. It will mark the 1 month of suspense for the countdown for me taking all the black politicians in Southeast Queens to Supreme Court. Let's see. We're talking about Councilman Comrie, bottom to the top, Councilman Comrie, Assemblywoman Vivian Cook, New York State Senator Malcolm Smith, New York State Senator Shirley Huntley, and Congressman Gregory W. Meeks, and a very good friend of Shirley Huntley's camp that helped really blow up this death threat stuff that put my ammo in the newspaper, none other than the Southeast Queens Press, with Dominic Rafter, the reporter, and Brian Rafferty, the publisher, the editor. You guys are wrong, man. You guys are wrong. You know you're wrong. Where Shirley Huntley got two newspapers working for her to get her reelected, that's not election fraud? You got a newspaper to put in there that ain't no homeless people in Queens and got your endorsement paper in there with a big color ad? Nice. Where'd you get the money for them TV commercials and radio commercials, Shirley Huntley? Where'd you get it? Where'd you get the money? Who donated money to your campaign? Do they have business in your district? Or is it because you're needed for that vote on the same-sex marriage thing? That's what it is. That's what it is. People putting their political ducks in a row, buying politicians through favors and through trading votes, and making sure they get somebody's proxy for a particular vote on the floor of the New York State Senate. That is crooked. You are not representing your constituents. You are representing politics. You are representing things that have nothing to do with your district. You're not representing your people. I'm homeless. Yeah, I'm staying at somebody's house. It's cold. I can't sleep on the beach no more. But I got a P.O. box in downtown Jamaica, and I'm a resident of your district. I'm homeless. Temporary stay at my mother's house. The woman that adopted me. And ain't you black Negroes ashamed? All you politicians with all that power, everything you can, I was going to run to the woman that adopted me years ago. That's our private life. I was in that apartment, and that was my inheritance from my biological mother by federal law. Y'all violated that. Y'all got to pay a price. You got to pay a price. If it's being exposed in the daily news, I don't care. New York Post, I don't care. But I'm taking you to court, and the congressman, I understand by law, has to contact the press about that. Well, the press going to get the court moving paper so they can come in here and say, aren't you supposed to call us? But if you're not obligated to, here we are. What's up? We got to pony up some answers, Congressman. Why is it that Philip Dreis can't get your office to repeat, put on paper, what Ida Smith vehemently say, that Natch is conducting a form of redlining? What about your office covering up the hangman's noose that was in the Brooklyn VA's motor pool for years? Your office covered it up. That was racism against black people in on federal land. And what you did was, your office did was, your office covered it up. Your office covered it up with some people at the VA in Brooklyn. Yes, you did. That's what happened. I know what happened. I'm the one that took the complaint. I'm the one that took the evidence to the congressman's office. I'm guilty. It's me. I did it. My hands are blue. Not red-handed, caught dead cold, like I got you guys. I'm telling you, man, I've given you all the opportunities to call and negotiate. As long as you didn't send somebody like Lester Muse to be talking to me like I'm his little kid. When the hell does this dude think I'm his kid? We don't have no nothing special there, brother. Yeah, we former Rangers. Yeah, we got a kinship. You should have observed the rules. You don't betray your brother.
We're all living in America. America, it's wunderbar. We're all living in America. America, America. We're all
weiß noch nicht, dass tanzen muss. Wir bilden We're all